television for entertainment and development. This is The Ted Channel.
Word of life, speak to my weary heart, strengthen my broken parts.
Dear friends and my beloved brothers and sisters in Christ, good morning, good afternoon, good evening. As always the case, I'm always very happy to be with you, although we do not see each other, but I know you are there, and it's a joy in my heart that we be studying the Word of God together. You are my inspiration. Because if no one watches and no one listens, well, I'll be like talking to the air. So whether you are a friend, a brother, and an enemy, I'll be even the worst enemy, that you will block me in all your life, I'm still happy you may be able to listen to me. Now I know my enemies always block me, not only in Facebook but in messengers. But they are not enemies of mine. They just think I am their enemy because I love them. But they block me or they ignore me and my messages. But it's all right. I am what I am. Just doing what I can do for the Lord and doing what I can do for my fellow men and doing what I can do to my friends and brethren and doing the best that I could to all that I love or loved ones. You may ignore me in your life, block me, or what? That's your right. But remember, what we sow, we will reap. So my position, brethren, is that my attitude is my attitude. I am normal and natural. Many will criticize me because of my preaching method and how I handle the Word of God. Others are hurt, but I do not mean to do it. I just say and state and discuss what is true to the Bible. I am very sorry. I am that kind of person. This is my life, as they say. My attitude and personality, God knows me and knows my heart. Mga kaigsunan o mga kaigalaan ko kang Kristo, maing buntag, maayong udtog, maing gabi, kanyong tanan, may hapon. Yeah. Kanunay kong manimbaya o gingon ni Ana tungod kay bisan kitang mga Cebuano, ng mga Pilipinhon, ang daghan ka na to, ng langyaw eh. Ng langyaw for the reason in the Philippines, you cannot earn what you like. Only few millionaires and the politicians are the one having our money. So, Filipinos generally are poor. So what we can do is to go abroad and work outside the Philippines so that we can earn something that is enough for the family, not in the Philippines. So I have to say that my Filipino brothers and sisters and friends, many are outside the Philippines. I hope you are there. Nagapaminaw ka na ko. Bisan asa ka mo. Meaning suok sa kalibutan. Well, I know. The media communication is a very big tool and asset for preachers. That when we preach, we will be heard all around the world. Although not all are doing this, but I'm urging all preachers, do it! If you have a cell phone like mine, this is given by a friend, I can preach and can be heard all around the world. So if I have done it, I can do it, you preachers can do it. We help each other in doing this. We'll hasten the day of the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because the Bible teaches that when the gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all parts of the world and every creature of the world, the end will come. And the end of that is the end of this age, and that is what we are longing and hoping for. So that we can escape the pains and sufferings of this world. But to those who are not ready, who are not Christians, of course, theirs will be forever destruction, forever everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord at the coming of Jesus Christ. So we must be ready at all times. Christ may come today, maybe tomorrow, maybe next month, maybe next year, but we do not know. So we must be ready. I know the Lord will not come anytime. His coming is not anytime. He's following a pattern, following a program, following a plan that is stored in the mind of the Father. The Lord says, no one knows, not you, not the angels in heaven, not even the Son of Man, meaning he, as a man, does not even know when he is coming. Only the Father knows. Since we do not know, we must be ready now. There are events that will happen before Christ comes. And we sometimes think this is the event, that is the event, so Christ will come. No, we cannot determine. When we based on tribulation, it will be after the great tribulation, that Christ will cut up the saints and render vengeance to them that know not God and obey not the gospel. We do not know when is the tribulation. We are in much tribulations today. Great tribulations. I am experiencing that. You are experiencing it. What if this is the tribulation discussed in the Bible? Well, what if not? Well, it's all right. Christ will come. Be ready, because we do not know whether the tribulations now is the tribulation that is being discussed in the Bible, that immediately after the tribulation, or that before the tribulation, he will cut up his hands. We don't know what that tribulation is, when that tribulation is. So, we better be ready. Okay, sa lahat ng mga Tagalog na mga kaibigan ko at mga kapatid ko kay Kristo, magandang umaga po, magandang hapon at magandang gabi sa inyong lahat. Gayon din sa lahat ng mga kahit na ipagpalagay natin na hindi kaibigan, yung may galit at alit sa akin, no problem. That is your right. But I do not consider anybody my enemy. I do not consider anybody my enemy. All people are my friends, whether I know them not. And all brothers and sisters, whether I do know them not, I love them all. That is my life. That is why when you are a brother or sister in Christ, in America it's different. Even if you are a brother or a sister, they just call you by name. Cyrus! Like that. Steve! Like that. Michael! Like that. But me, I have different mentality. I must recognize the fact that you are a brother and a sister in Christ. So I always say, Brother Steve, Brother Michael, kapatid na Mike, Brother Larry, Sister Catherine, Catherine, Katrina, Sister Regina. Oh, my mother is Regina, my mother in the flesh. And I have also somebody I called Mom or Mommy because Papa, Mama, I call her Mama. An American sister, as old as my mother. And they have the same name. And she is Sister Regina Mullins, the wife of Brother Earl Mullins, Senior. And I call them Papa and Mama. Mama Regina, Papa Earl. Well, that's the meaning very close to my heart. And I have American dad, but he passed away about 4 or 5 years ago. That is dad, Thomas Clark. But now, his son, Brother Steve Clark, is my very close brother and friend. He is backing me up in my work. That is it. I love all. I respect all. I'm very happy working because there are also people who love me and cannot block me in their messenger because they love me. But also that they block me, they ignore if ever they did not block me. So I'm still happy. And I can preach to you now or teach a lesson. Our lesson today, because I don't know what one to keep on talking Bible. Some says that's boring. We better talk like friends and brothers, talking with each other, conversing, telling stories. That's good. Anyway, it's 1 hour. You can spend the time, the first 30 minutes of talking, then the second 30 minutes is full of preaching. But anyway, last lesson today is a continuation of the previous lessons concerning the second coming of Christ. We already have studied much about the second coming of Christ. When will it happen? How it will happen? And what are the concomitants of his coming? It is there in the Bible. His second coming is a series, not just one event. Some will just say it's one event. He comes at the end of everything, nothing more. It's very hard, like magic. But in the Bible, biblically, there is a series of events that is being followed when Jesus comes again. He came as a lamb. At his second coming, he will come as a lion, a warrior. He came first as a savior. He will come back as a warrior. I tell you, he did not come yet as a warrior, but he will come as a warrior. He will be the lion of the tribe of Judah. A latter David. The first David was gone, but this is a latter David. The lion of the tribe of Judah, referring to the second coming of Christ, that he will be a warrior like David. First coming, a lamb, and now a shepherd, but comes as a lion of the tribe of Judah, warrior. And our lesson is about the second coming and the Lord's Supper, or the Lord's Supper and the second coming, because they are related. They are related scripturally. Now, we have studied last time that at least all churches and even all denominations, including the Roman Catholic Church, observe the Lord's Supper. Observe the Lord's Supper. Some once a year, some once a month, some quarterly, some twice a year. Some depends on what they like, and some, of course, partakes of the Lord's Supper, partake of the Lord's Supper every Sunday, every first day of the week, and one of which is the churches of Christ, in which where I belong. And the Bible teaches that it is a communion of the body and blood of Jesus Christ. There are many interpretations as to what will happen to the bread and the grape juice. Some say there is magic that will happen, that the bread will become a real flesh of the Lord, and the fruit of the vine or the wine becomes a real blood of the Lord. They call it transubstantiation. So it's like a magic. Once the blessing is made, after the prayer, you can notice that the bread turns into a flesh, and that is flesh of Jesus Christ, and then the wine turns into blood, so that is the blood of Jesus Christ. Well, whatever, it is partaking of the Lord's Supper. Then there is also believed it as consubstantiation. It is still bread as you look at it, and it's still grape juice as you look at it, but the real flesh and real blood, body or blood of Jesus Christ goes with it. It is with it. When you eat and drink, you eat the flesh and blood of Jesus Christ with the bread and the grape juice. And among churches of Christ like me, they say it is representation of the body and blood of Jesus Christ. It is real and always real. Nothing is added to it being bread and it being the fruit of the vine. No changes at all. Nothing is added. But representing Christ's flesh or body and Christ's blood, that is ours in the churches of Christ. But we used to pray in prayer that this bread is your body and this grape juice is your blood, because that is what Jesus said in Matthew 26 when he officiated for the first time the Lord's Supper after eating his last supper. He said, "Take, eat, this is my body. Then drink, this is my blood." So Jesus said, that is real bread, literal. That is real grape juice or wine, literal. But that is my body and that is my blood. So that is how we understand it. It is a representation of his body and blood. But when we pray, bless us as we partake of your body. Bless us as we drink your blood. Of course, what we drink and what we eat is the literal grape juice and the literal bread. Now, in the Bible, the observance is made on the first day of the week, Sunday. Acts 2:42 says, they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. When they meet together, they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. And in breaking of bread, and in fellowship, that is collection, giving, or offering is fellowship, and in prayers, and they sang together when they gathered together, Ephesians 5:19. So those are the things done when there is a gathering for worship among Christians in the first century, or when the church was established on the day of Pentecost. They studied the Bible. So we can study the Bible by way of preaching and a Bible study, presenting lessons where everybody can share. Then there is the breaking of bread. It is not an ordinary meal, but it is a breaking of bread during the worship. And that really refers to the Lord's Supper. And then there is the fellowship, the giving, the offering, the contribution for the saints, according to 1 Corinthians 16:1 and 2. And there are prayers and singing, with the accompaniment of the heart, making melody in the heart. Well, that is it. But we are now focusing ourselves on the Lord's Supper, the breaking of bread. There are those who will use Acts 2:46, because there is also a breaking, eating of bread every day. That is the Catholic position, that is, it can be partaken every day, because they partook of it every day according to the Catholic position. But in reading 2:46, it is not the breaking of bread which is the Lord's Supper. It is breaking of bread which is an ordinary meal. Why? Because they have meat. They eat their meat with singleness of heart. So there is meat. There might be pork, or it might be beef. That is not the Lord's Supper. But anyway, if you think it is, well, it's all right. No problem. But the example that I can find in the Bible, they partook of it every first day of the week. Upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay by him in store. That refers to distribution or contribution, giving, the offering. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, 1 and 2. So, giving also, or offering of our, you know, our giving, of our contribution, is being done upon the first day of the week. And all denominations are doing it because it is upon the first day of the week. Now, about the Lord's Supper, the breaking of bread, it says in Acts 20, verse 7, actually, verse 1 to 6, Paul and his company were traveling from place to place. They were not gathering with the saints. And on the seventh day, they were still there. In Troas, nothing was done. But it says in verse 7, and upon the first day of the week. Now, we understand, upon the first day of the week means every first day of the week. And upon the first day of the week. That's identical with 1 Corinthians 16, 1 and 2. Upon the first day of the week, give. Upon the first day of the week, when we were gathered together to break bread. So the gathering on the first day of the week, or every first day of the week, the purpose is for the breaking of bread, having the Lord's Supper, to remember the death of Jesus Christ and to proclaim His second coming. See? Upon the first day of the week, we were gathered together to break bread. So it was a custom. It was their practice that they gather on the first day of the week to break bread. Now how many first days of the week is 1 year? 52. So you must partake of the Lord's Supper 52 times a year. Not once a year, not twice a year, not once a month, because there are those who will decide. We will do it once a month, we'll do it trimester, we'll do it quarterly, and so on. It is the Lord's will that must be done, not ours. And according to the example set forth in the New Testament, it is being done on the first day of the week, meaning 52 Sundays or 52 first day. Days of the week in a year. That is the regularity of doing the breaking of bread or partaking of the Lord's Supper. Because Paul said, as often. And he said, when you meet together, as often, you do it. In fact, you have to wait one for another in that Lord's Supper. That is why we sometimes are late in starting our church worship on Sundays, because we wait for others so that they will not be late for the Lord's Supper. Yeah, you can read that 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23 to 30, that we have to do it regularly. And the regularity that is found in the Bible is first day of the week, every Sunday. We do it every Sunday. The regularity of it is on that day because it is by partaking of the Lord's Supper that we remember His death and then we proclaim His second coming. So, three things really will happen when you partake of the Lord's Supper. One is, it is retrospective, meaning remembering what has already been done, that is the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it is introspective, because we will examine ourselves, according to Paul in 1 Corinthians 11. Examine, so that we will partake of it worthily, meaning the manner of partaking is correct, worthy. It is adverb of manner, worthily. Partake it worthily. It is not whether you committed sin or not, or whether you are righteous or not, or whatever. No, it is not conditioned on that. Some will not partake the Lord for the reason that he quarreled somebody. He has a problem with somebody. No, that is not the reason for being disqualified or partaking. The disqualification is when you partake unworthily. The manner is not right. And Paul discussed it in the early verses of 1 Corinthians 11, that they partake of the Lord's Supper unworthily. Why? Some are drinking much, some cannot drink anymore, consumed by others. The worthy manner is, it must be done decently and in order. 1 Corinthians 14:40. Everything must be done in decent manner, and orderly, organized. Okay. Now, the first day of the week, regularity. And then it is retrospective because we look back on the death of Jesus Christ. It is introspective because we have to examine ourselves, and it is prospective because we are looking forward of the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now there is a question concerning the Lord's Supper, which is questioned by others. It is about how many cups are to be used. Well, how many cups are to be used? One cup? Actually, there are different opinions and ideas. And I will not contradict the opinions and ideas, provided the Lord's Supper is partaken. There is no question about the number of cups used or number of containers used, provided the Lord's Supper is observed. At that Passover, before Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper, that is the supper of the Passover, there was, if you will study the Old Testament, there are four cups. Four cups. But I didn't question that at this Passover feast. Passover supper. 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 I don't know. I am after of the Lord's Supper because this cup. Drink this cup. And it is singular. So if the rivers took the container, there must be one container only. Because it is singular, drink this cup. A cup of coffee, like what I have, mug, excuse me, is singular, a cup. But I will never drink a cup. But I drink a cup of coffee. Meaning, what I drink really is coffee. So, the cup refers to the coffee, not the container. Because I do not drink the container. The container. I drink the content. So, cup of coffee means I will drink the coffee, not the cup which is container. The cup which is the content. It's like that. Drink this cup. And then Jesus said, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine or the grape juice until I drink it new with you in the kingdom. So he was declaring that the cup he was talking about was the content, the grape juice, the wine. Whether it is divided into many containers, small containers, it is still one cup. it is still the grape juice. It is still the fruit of the vine. Guess what? Okay? In fact, the grape juice is not only one fruit of the vine. No. How can you extract much juices with only one single fruit of the vine? But the meaning of the fruit of the vine there is this, that which is made a juice from different fruits of the vine. But the Lord said, fruit of the vine. He did not say fruits of the vine. Singular, but plural. It is like a coffee, 2-in-1, or 3-in-1, or 4-in-1. There are coffee now, 11-in-1. Now, in the institution of the Lord's Supper, first that the Lord will let the disciples do is eat bread. And after eating the bread will be the drinking of the so-called cup of the fruit of the vine. And in, I think we will try to read in the Bible. I have to change glasses so I can read. Read in the Bible in Luke chapter 22. And let us see what's the instruction of the Lord concerning the cup or the fruit of the vine that they will drink. Now, I will read 22 verse 14 to verse 21 or 20. Okay. And when the hour was come, that was after they ate the Passover supper or the last supper of the Lord. And when the hour was come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him. And he said unto them, with desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffering. For I say unto you, I will not anymore eat thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Now, and he took the cup, and gave thanks, and said, take this, and give, and divide it among yourselves. So, the cup of the fruit of the vine, the grape juice, the wine, was divided among them. Well, it might be the divided by sipping. In one cup, one container. So, you sip, I sip, the other sip. That's how they divided it. If that is. But how could it be? They divided it first. And then after it was divided, the Bible says, for I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come. The fruit of the vine is the cup, not the container. He told them to divide the fruit of the vine, meaning the grape juice, not the container. If they will divide the container, will they break the container? They will break the container. But it says, divide it. And what is to be divided? The fruit of the vine, meaning the grape juice. And then, but first, they just divided it. They did not drink it. Because it is in verse 19, and he took bread. So the division was made, verse 17. It is divided. Then after they divided it, the Lord took bread and gave thanks and break it and gave unto them, saying, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. That is now the Lord's Supper. So he first gave to his disciples the bread to eat. They partook of it. But they divided first the grape juice. Not the container. The grape juice, they divided. And then, after they ate the bread, likewise also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. So the cup is not the container, but the blood of Jesus Christ, represented by the grape juice. And they were divided, or it was divided, before they ate bread. And after they eat the bread, they drink what they have divided. Drink this cup. What is that cup? The cup which you divided. The fruit of the vine. So they divided first the fruit of the vine before eating the bread. And after the eating the bread, they drink the cup which they have already divided. Now what do you think? They have divided it in their mouths. Sip, sip, sip. Drink a little, then drink a little. No. In Cebuano, did not say dimdimanay mo. Dimdimanay wala. They divided first the grape juice. And after it was divided, they ate the bread and drink the divided grape juice. Now where did they divide it? There is a table, because it is the Lord's table. In 1 Corinthians 10, it is called the Lord's table. There is the table. How will it be divided? By pouring on the table? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Or they have kind of small containers where they divided the fruit of the vine. From that one big container, they divided into small containers. And then after they divided it there, the divided grape juice was laying on the table. And then the Lord took bread, blessed it, and he said, take, eat, every one of you. This is my body, this do in remembrance of me. Then after the partaking of the bread, they were instructed to drink what? The divided grape juice. So when they drink, what they drink was what already divided before they ate. I think that is very clear. So, we do it on Sundays, we divide. We divide. And then, when we have the Lord's Supper, first, prayer for the bread. Then prayer for the cup. What is that? The vine, the fruit of the vine. The divided. Already divided before the partaking of bread. That is why we prepare it on the Lord's table every Sunday, every first day of the week. That is an idea. And so, yeah, I think I missed the alarm. I will pause for a letter. I think. Pause for a letter for a station break.
Television for entertainment and development. This is the Dead Channel.
Wonder Tree, ang kahibulungan niya kahoy nga makatangtang sa bisan unsang klase nga balatian sa tao, mga pataas sa kinabuhi ug mga palagsik sa lawas. Usa ka talagsaon apan nasulayan na sa kadaghanan nga epektibo ug makaayo sa tanang matang sa sakit sa tao. Wonder Tree. Ang Wonder Tree usa ka kahibulungan niya kahoy nga nadiskubrian karon nga nagbaton og talagsaon ug kahibulungan nga tambal. Wonder Tree. Adunay sangkap sa nagkalain-laing binuhat nga tambal sama sa lana, vino o gamot sa kahoy. Walay allergy o infection. Kay kini usaman ng kabinisaya nga tambal nga nasulayan na sa kadaghanan. Ayaw kalimot! Wonder Tree! Ang Wonder Tree mapalit sa TED Channel o sa Agora sa FNG and Sans Carinderia.
Television for entertainment and development. This is the TED Channel.
Okay, thank you. Let's continue. So, those using one cup where they drink one after the other. What if there are 3,000 members? I tried to estimate the baptized people on the day of Pentecost, 5,000 men, 3,000 men, excluding women. But I just made the calculation of the 3,000 people. First, the prayer for the bread. So it will be distributed to 3,000 people. That will take long. Number two, the bread. And everyone sips from one container, not two. According to the one cuppers, that it is singular, so one container only. How big is the container? Is it a drum? A big container? So who will carry that in order that each one will partake? It will be carried by the preacher, maybe. Then estimated that every participant will consume about 1 minute eating of the bread, and then drinking, sipping, and then prayers. So it will be 1 minute every participant. So it will mean that it will need 3,000 minutes to accomplish the Lord's Supper. Now, how many minutes per hour? 60 minutes. Times 24 hours. You will begin maybe 9 o'clock in the morning, Sundays. Or maybe that is the beginning of the service. So you can partake of the Lord's Supper 11 o'clock, maybe. Now I tried to figure it out. And you will finish the breaking of bread and drinking from that one container, big container, Tuesday. So it will not be first day of the week anymore. It includes Monday and it includes Wednesday, Tuesday. But if it is poured first before the service begins, poured first in small containers, because the cup is the wine, the cup is the grape juice, you pour the cup, the content, to the containers, 3,000 containers, small containers. If you do it that way, it will not take long, and the Lord's Supper is over. Practicality, decently, and in order. It cannot be decent if you drink following one another in the same container. And it cannot be orderly. Whereas if it is divided, first before the service, and then after partake of the bread, it will be distributed by ushers, because it is not one container, but one content, the Lord's, the scriptures. It is easy. Decently and in order. But I am not against of those who are using one container only. They can sacrifice, carrying a big drum to let the people participate in the sipping from that one container. Even if they will finish Tuesday, it's all right. It's their prerogative. But most of the congregation, of course, the most are 100 people, so it's all right. As long as it is partaking of the Lord's Supper, there is no problem. But the decency and orderliness is somewhat violated. And then, the question is, when they have it and on the did they do it according to the instruction of the Lord? Yes, they divided first the contents. That is the one cup, the content, because that is the fruit of the vine. The cup there is the fruit of the vine. So they divided it first. Then they have the service. Then after that, there was a prayer for the bread, and after that, prayer for the cup. What is that? Those that were already placed in several containers, divided already, because they will divide it before the service begins. That is the example of Jesus Christ in Luke chapter 22, the instruction. Okay. So that is it, brethren. But there is, most are using several cups, several containers for that one cup, which is the fruit of the vine or the grape juice. But there is also a church now, we're having only one cup, or one container, and a small container. It is the Catholic Church. The priest having one small container. But the problem is, he is the only one who drinks. The others will not. That's the difference. So, the one cuppers, the one container advocates, have a company. The Catholic Church, our friends, also have one cup, one container. Every time there is Mass. Okay, I think that is it as far as the number of containers is concerned. Container of the one cup, which is the fruit or the grape juice, fruit of the vine, the wine. But the most important is, when we do Lord's Supper, we are remembering the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we are looking forward at His coming, at the same time examining ourselves whether we are worthy or taking it worthily or not. So every Sunday that is being done among churches of Christ, so I would like this opportunity to tell the members of the Church of the Lord around the globe, do not skip, if possible, the Lord's Supper participation. Because the promise of the Lord, when He first instituted that Lord's Supper, that is not really our supper, but the Lord's, But we are to partake it to remember his death. He said that he will eat and drink of it again in the kingdom. And that is the church, we know that. Different aspects of the kingdom. The kingdom now is the church. So when the first day of the week comes, where we all together to worship the Lord and partake of the Lord's Supper, the Lord is there. Please, Christians and members of the Lord's church, do not disappoint the Lord. It is an appointment with the Lord. He will eat and drink with us at the time when we partake of the bread and the wine of the Lord's Supper. He is there present. You might not see him, but he is there. So every gathering on the first day of the week, where we gather together to eat, to break bread, the Lord Jesus Christ is there with us. It is very important that we be there, as the Lord is present during our service, during the partaking of bread, he is there. If you are not there, the Lord is waiting for you. That is why the instruction of Paul in 1 Corinthians 11, that we tarry one another. We wait. Because the Lord is waiting. And I believe every Sunday the Lord is there already before we arrive the gathering place or the meeting place. The church should do it heartily and with desire of doing it, because the Lord is there to partake the Lord's Supper with us. In fact, in the Bible, in the book of Hebrews, the Lord said, in the midst of the congregation, in the midst of the church, will I sing praises unto thee. So when we sing praises on Sundays, or when we gather together to worship and meditate on the Lord, Jesus Christ is there to sing with us. He will sing with the congregation. He not only ate the supper, the Lord's Supper with us, but also he will sing with us. And in prayers, he is also there. The Bible says we do not know how to pray as we ought. Romans 8:25-26. But the Spirit of the Lord will help us to pray. So even in praying, the Lord is there. And you know what? When we pray the closing prayer before we depart from the meeting place, from the building where the church meets, we pray, Lord, be with us as we go home. Meaning the Lord is there. And we are asking him to go with us as we go home so that we will have a safe travel or whatever. It is very important that we know this, brethren. how important is the partaking of the Lord's Supper. Not only because we remember the death of the Lord Jesus Christ who died for our sins, and to look forward for His second coming, proclamation of His coming is the Lord's Supper. Lord's Supper is proclamation of His coming. But the presence of the Lord spiritually is always with us when we partake of it. That's His promise. And He is fulfilling and will fulfill His promise. It will be partaken until the Lord comes. Since the Lord has not come yet, we are told to partake of it. We will stop partaking when the Lord already comes. There's no use. Because He will be, if He is already come, He has already come. There's no use. Well, I heard there are some congregations that are partaking of the bread and the grape juice on the first day of the week for the reason that the Lord has come in 70 AD, at the destruction of Jerusalem, D.O.G. Yeah. It's 1 hour. D.O.G. Destruction of Jerusalem. But the one who appeared at the destruction of Jerusalem is not the Lord Jesus Christ. It was General Titus of the Roman Empire, dictating his army, commanding his army to destroy everything in Jerusalem. It was not the Lord. When the Lord comes, of course, He will make war against the nations, but not Israel. When Titus came in 70 AD, he destroyed Jerusalem, meaning Israel. But when the Lord comes, He will not destroy Israel. He will not destroy Jerusalem, but He will destroy all nations that made war, that destroyed Jerusalem, meaning all the kingdoms of this world. So, there is really no valid argument to argue that Jesus came in 70 AD. It was not Jesus. It was Titus who came and destroyed Jerusalem. When Jesus comes back, He will not destroy Jerusalem, but He will destroy all the nations that destroyed Jerusalem in 70 AD. And that will be the end of our partaking of the Lord's Supper. The church will be caught up, will be raptured. There is no partaking of the Lord's Supper up in heaven. But there will be the myriads. So that Christ will no longer be the groom and the church be the bride, but husband and wife. It will be the myriads. Ceremony will be in heaven, meaning the church is caught up, is raptured, and ceremony will be done there. And after that myriad ceremony, Christ will come down to make war against the nations of the earth. Then that is the series in Revelation 19, 20, 21, 22. And in this series we find that Christ will come first, before the 1,000 years binding of Satan. Meaning, He will come before 1,000 years. He will come pre-1,000 years. And 1,000 years means millennial, so He will come pre-millennial. His coming is pre-millennial. Well, that's the coming. And it is connected with our partaking of the Lord's Supper now. Now, until at the second coming at the coming down. First is the supper of the myriads of the Lamb. See? So there is Lord's Supper now. But the last supper before Christ comes down to earth or to the nations of the earth will be the myriads supper of the Lamb. Okay, that's 1 hour. So I have to say bye-bye for now and hope to be with you again next time. Thank you very much for watching, listening, and maybe sharing to others. God bless us all.
Television for entertainment and development. This is the Ted Channel.